Rachida lives in the village of Fren Ali, near Wedlao, in the region of Tetouan. Like most of the women in her village, Rachida is a potter. Today is the first day of the week, the day when the women go to collect the clay to which the pottery of Fren Ali owes its reputation. This treasure lies hidden under the hills surrounding the village. But like all treasure, clay is also synonymous with sweat, fear, and occasionally blood. The women dig deeper and deeper holes, which sometimes become veritable caverns. These unsupported caverns could cave in at any moment. But Rachida is always very careful. After several hours digging, Rachida returns home. She has collected a lot of clay, but it has been a long and tiring day. On the second day, Rachida and her daughter prepare the clay. They have to beat it, crush it, then sieve it in order to obtain a fine powder. When mixed with water, this powder becomes the basic material used for all forms of pottery. And it's with this material that Rachida starts throwing pots on the third day. She uses a rudimentary potter's wheel without an axle. Each piece is made on a clay disc, simply placed on top of another piece. The kneaded clay is shaped into a thick round slab, then pressed out from the inside to give the pot its form. Additional clay is mainly worked from the centre. Rachida refines the shape, then smooths the pot with a damp cloth. The pieces are left to dry in the sun before being coated. The coating, or slip, which is made of red clay from the beach, is burnished with a small stone. This helps to reinforce the pot's structure and results in a smooth, even surface. The pots are then left to dry again in the sun. The women continue making pots on the fourth day. They usually make small series of the same type: cooking pots, burners, tagine, or like here, tagine lids. While the women work, the village men go to fetch wood in the hills. The best wood for firing pottery is tuya, especially the roots. The tuya is a slow-growing tree, and as a result, its wood is very dense. But the tuya takes more than 100 years to grow to its full height, and its overexploitation means the men have to go further and further to find it. And so, little by little, the hills are being deforested. Rachida carries on making pots on the fifth day. Here, she's making a small charcoal burner known as a mejmar. It takes years and years of practice to have Rashida's skill and sureness of touch. After drying the pieces in the sun, Rachida and the other women put them in the bread oven. This is always done in the evening. First, the floor of the oven is covered with tuya roots. Twia is the only type of wood that produces the very high temperatures, 800 to 900 degrees Celsius, needed for firing. Then the pots and the wood are packed closely together in the oven, leaving as few gaps as possible. The oven doesn't have a door, and it's the pots themselves that block it. The firing process takes all night. On the morning of the sixth day, the pieces are removed from the oven, which is still very hot. They are individually checked before being taken to the house of Rachida's father, who sells them all over Morocco. The pottery of Fran Ali is renowned for its quality and, above all, for its shock-resistant and heat-resistant properties. On the morning of the seventh day, the whole village goes to the local souk. The pots are carefully loaded onto donkeys. It takes over an hour on foot to reach Sept de Beni Said Souk in the plain of Wed Laou. At the souk, the customers are very difficult, and the village women have the opportunity to compare the quality of their pottery. The unchanging seven-day cycle ends here. But for Rachida and all the other potters in Fran Ali, it will start all over again tomorrow. Further east, in the region of Al Hoceima, near the village of Ida Dushen, home of the Beni Ouriaghel tribe, the clay is not sufficiently oily. Because of this, the pottery here is made with a mixture of small fired pots, which are broken and crushed, and a type of soil known as ashkouf. The pots in this area are smaller and are designed to hold liquids. Hence their extreme fineness and the delicateness with which they are made. Once the finished pots are dry, they undergo an initial firing in the kiln to harden them. The men go off to collect small leaves in the surrounding hills. These leaves will be pounded to produce vegetable dye. The potters then painstakingly paint signs on the pieces. Although the signs are never identical, they are always on the same traditional themes, whose meaning has been lost in the mists of time. For a second time at a low temperature. This fixes the paint and changes its colour. The region of Beni Zerouel in the south of the reef is famous for its large pots. And the best potters are to be found in the village of Ain Bouchrik. Here too, the clay has to be enriched with ashkouf before being prepared. But the way in which the clay is worked and modelled into pots is quite different. The clay is shaped into round slabs. These slabs are then placed on top of each other, and the joins are reinforced. After each step, the pots are left to harden in the sun. The body is then smoothed with a stone. Once the finished pots are dry, they can be dyed different colours before being painted. The villagers use pigments made from minerals. The black is obtained from manganese oxide and the red from iron oxide. The decorative motifs date back to very ancient times and make these pots resemble genuine antiques. Because of their size, these pots cannot be fired in a traditional bread oven. Instead, they're stacked on top of each other on a bed of dead branches, then covered with a mixture of cow dung and straw, which serves as the oven's walls and as the fuel. Firing always takes place at night because it's easier to see whether the walls are airtight. By morning, the pots look as if they're lying in a field of lava or among the ruins of Pompeii. They're carefully separated before being stored until they are sold.